Hey, what's up, guys? Coach Mack, playfastfootball.blogspot.com. Today we're going to talk a little bit about spacing concepts. And basically what spacing concepts are ways of horizontally attacking a defense by putting players in position to get two-on-one, three-on-two matchups so that you are putting a player inside of a defender and a player outside of a defender to try and create some type of conflict on that defender. All right. The reason I think spacing concepts are so popular and I think they're important in high school is because they are intermediate throws that most high school kids can make. All right. So when you talk about the passing game, you have to understand that within your protection schemes and within your quarterback's ability, there are a lot of great theories out there that maybe your quarterback can't throw at the high school level. So you get in a situation where you want to throw four verticals and you want to be able to convert those routes, and maybe two has to, on the front side, has either a sit down or a bender, and the outside guys are going to run read comebacks to where if they get even, they're leaving to make it a vertical. If they don't get even, they're going to pull it into a comeback. Lots of those throws end up becoming down the middle of the field, 20 to 25 yard throws. And on the outside, to the sideline on the comeback, sometimes they might be 25 yards or above, depending on how long the comeback is. And if the ball is in the middle and you're throwing it to the numbers or outside the numbers on a 12 to 10 yard comeback, that throw can get upwards of 25 yards sometimes. So a lot of times there's concepts that are really good concepts that maybe your quarterback can't throw. So when you go to spacing concepts, these are going to be intermediate routes that are going to be 10 to 12 yard throws that most high school quarterbacks should be able to make. So I think they're important because it's a way to take advantage of spot drop or pattern match defenses. If you understand how teams play pattern match out of certain formations, then you can understand how you can place receivers in certain spots, i.e. spacing, to horizontally stretch to take advantage of the six underneath zones, when a lot of times guys don't have that many players to match all of those zones. So what I've got drawn up first here is a simple, this is our three-man snag concept. We've talked about it a lot before, all right, where we've got a snag by one, a corner by two, and we're working a flat route by the back. Okay, so what we like to do is we like to push the back out pre-snap with a little bit of motion to get him out there, because the width is what we're trying to attack on the defense. Now, this three-man snag has a vertical concept to it. So that's one of the reasons we like this play, is because there is a vertical concept to it, with the ability to, at least on half the field, the ability to get a ball vertically down the field. But more often than not, when we run this concept, the concept ends up coming down to the snag and the flat. So when we have a vertical component in the passing game, we will read it from top down. So we will normally read this play, corner, snag, flat, when we have a vertical component. All right. But when you understand how teams are going to play defense, and when you understand how teams are going to pattern match, what ends up happening is the good defenses start to expand this player with the width of the tailback. And then when the tailback pushes, the good Mike linebackers will understand that their drop now pushes, okay? And the good Mike linebackers, unless you can run QB draw at them enough, or unless you have other things to take advantage inside the box, the good Mike linebackers are going to find that new number three, and they're going to drop and get underneath that snag. Now, we don't mind that so much because we have some things that we do, whether it be Q draw, or the best one is either a levels or a win concept on the backside, so that when teams push that mic, you can get one of your best players singled up on a Will, who now has to understand with three away, he cannot let two cross his face. So if this guy's going to try and be a wall or a short wall of two player, if you have a really good inside slot defender, you can work to where you get this guy head up, and he can win either over the top and back, or he can win with a head stick and get under and back, and you try and take care of that window that the mic is vacating for in his pass drop. All right, so when you're running this type of concept, you have to have answers for a mic that's going to push all the way over, all right, to that new number three in the snag concept. Well, in this concept of defense, when they are playing a palms or a two read scheme, they are really only playing with three underneath defenders, depending on the routes of the number two receiver. If this number two receiver never goes to the flat, this corner really is almost never going to trigger down. So you don't have to worry about another underneath defender if you run your routes, the routes that you run versus that coverage. If you understand what the coverage is built to do, you can understand where you can get players in space, and with the spacing concept, you can understand how to put a lot of pressure on certain individuals to slow that down. So one of the first things we'll do is we'll tag that concept, and we'll make the number two now come in here to run a spot right over the guard. The number one will still run his snag, and he's going to be about 5 yards outside the tackle box, but really what we tell him is, whoever that flat apex defender is, you push his hip as hard as you can. As soon as he crosses it, your face, you sit down. If he never crosses your face, you sit down on his outside hip. What's going to happen now is, in this concept of defense with these releases, usually these two players will not come down off of those two releases. So that when your back pushes the flat, you rarely ever get a corner that triggers down or a safety that triggers down. You normally get some type of slow pedal or shuffle and then avoid where they are trying to defend the corner routes. They're trying to defend balls that are in that area of the field that can kind of get them in trouble. So if you never release two to the flat, you usually or generally will not get that corner to trigger down. Now, if it's a cover two team where the corner is already down there, now you've got a little bit of an issue because they can handle this type of scenario in a cover two setting, because now they can stay inside the spot of two, inside the snag of one, and have that ball coming back out to the corner. Now, if that occurs, then there's other things that you can do in the passing game, because now with a hard flat player, they don't have as much help for the free safety on the corner ball and the deep middle hole. All right, so then you start getting into your four verticals or, you know, cover two type beaters where you're running maybe some type of smash route and you're isolating one-on-one to where the corner, if he's a hard cover two corner, all right, he can't really help the deep ball if you put somebody in the flat. Now, the good ones can sink a little bit, bait you, and then play the flat. But in general, the reason they're playing two read is because if it's four verticals or vertical threats, they haven't defended. If you push number two to the flat, they come down and make it cover two. So vertical releases turn into quarters, and flat releases by number two turn into cover two. So it's a really good coverage versus two detached receivers. But a lot of times what will happen is when you get this type of coverage, if you can run a spacing concept where you've got a player over the guard, a player on the outside hip of the apex defender or 5 yards off the tackle box, and a player pushing the flat, in this version of coverage, what happens now is when the mic goes to push, all right, the final three is now that player. So when the mic goes to push, he's going to have to relate to and drop to the final three as the routes declare themselves, not the three when the formation lines up. It's after the distribution of the routes that declares that mic's drop. So the new three is there. So now this player was originally two doesn't cross my face, three doesn't out-leverage me. All right? So now when he goes to drop, this was the original three working with width, so he's thinking that he can't get out-leveraged. So now what has to happen is he starts to expand so he doesn't get out-leveraged by the back. Normally, when we have the vertical corner route going on, the mic can push to this snag route. Well, now what you've done with a snag and a spot is you put the defense in a situation where if that's the coverage and you know that's what the coverage is, you end up with two guys on the Sam linebacker The snag and the flare pushes them immediately. So what happens is your quarterback, it's going to be what we call a rhythm three, punch one, two, three, ball out on his last step. It's not going to be a hitch and hold. It's not going to be three and hold. It's going to be three and throw. So when his last foot hits the ground, he's ready to make a throw. Now, when we go to spacing concepts, normally we go kind of outside in, all right, and we read this first. Now, the reason for that, and I'm not saying that this is the correct way to do it. I'm saying it's the way we do it. That's going to be the furthest, longest throw. And if you read that last, by the time the quarterback makes it, a lot of times that guy starts turning up the field, and that's where the corner can get involved and make some plays. We want this guy to get the ball in space with leverage. If he has leverage or he's outside that apex defender, we'd like to get it to him as soon as we can, so now he has a chance to catch this and make people miss. So we read the spacing concept from outside in. The corner concept we read from top down. The spacing we read from outside in, because I think this is the hardest throw for the quarterback to make. So when his foot hits the ground, if this guy's got leverage, we want to get him the ball. If this guy doesn't have leverage, okay, now he's got to go back inside to the spot and the snag. And normally what's going to happen in this concept, if this back doesn't have leverage, it's because he pushed. He's going to expect to get help from the mic on this route, but we ate the mic up with the inside spot route. So when you're playing pattern match teams, what ends up happening is you have to use some concepts that'll eat up some of the pattern match players and get them to match certain routes so that you can get two-on-one where you want. Now, if you were playing a spot drop team or an eight-man front three deep team, it's even better, because that's one of the reasons a lot of teams got out of spot dropping or straight cover three, country cover three, simply because they run out of guys in space to cover. And then what they have to do is they have to hold windows with a little bit more depth so that they can drive the leverage, all right, of the swing routes and the outside routes. So if you were seeing a traditional one high cover three team, well, now what's going to happen is you're going to push here, try and get to the guard if you can. You're going to push here, outside shoulder, and you're still going to push the flare. Well, what happens now is this guy's a curl or a hook curl dropper. This guy's a curl flat dropper. They've only got two underneath droppers to that side in a three deep scenario. They've got two underneath droppers, and we put a guy in the short hook, a guy in the short curl or the mini curl, and we put a guy in the flat. So we've got three offensive players, on their two defenders. So if you find a team that's a spot drop team or an eight man front cover three team that spot drops and doesn't match routes, it's still a good concept, because you're going to put three offensive players in an area that only has two defenders. So we want to get one more offensive player than they have defenders in drop areas. So a lot of times with pattern match teams, that's how they always create numbers, is they push guys so that they can always get 4-on-3, 3-on-2. So what you have to understand is, when you're getting those types of concepts, how can you eat up the pattern match players? You got to run routes that are going to force them to match those patterns, so that when they match them, so now the pattern match team, the mic gets eaten up by that new number three, because that's his rule. Now you get 2-on-1 by going snag out here, push the flare outside. And then, like I said, what we like to do is, after, when we know we're getting mic push teams, we like to have some things built in on the backside to win, to get the ball to our players. They could be smoke screens, they could be levels. All right, you could run a levels concept on the backside, where now when you get Mike push, now the quarterback automatically is going to turn and read the will. If the will is trying to wall out the number two, then you get the ball to the 5-yard fin route here. All right, if the number two clears the will, then you're going to try and look to throw in the window vacated by the pushed mic, and you're going to try and make this guy come up and be a ball player. And he's going to have to play that route vertical and drive that. And that's not a bad scenario to get to, because once you know that he's going to drive that 10-yard dig, now you got some things that you can throw over his head. So spacing concepts are good versus spot drop teams, and they're really good against pattern match teams. So one of the next things we like to do is we like to go 3x1. And try and create 4 to a side for spacing. So we like to go 3x1. And let's just say, for argument's sake, they may play their trips coverages based on where the back is. All right, they may play their trips coverages based on who your number one is. But for argument's sake, let's say you're getting a concept where it stays 2-read there and the weak safety. All right, the weak safety is going to pull 3 vertical on the other side, solo, poach, trio, whatever you might want to call that. Okay. What you now have to understand is where you're trying to get the spacing routes, right, and what you're trying to do. So when you push the back, what you're trying to see is how does that defense relate to those. So one of the first things you can do is you can push the back, you can clear out and get this guy out vertical, and you can run spot here, snag here. All right, spot there and snag there. Okay. Now, what's going to happen when you are playing a structure or a team that plays defense like this is the Goodwill linebacker, they're going to bump it all, okay, and they're going to go ahead and take him to bump and get width to the flare route. The Mike is going to bump and push the snag, and then the Will, because it's 4 strong, will cut, all right? He will cut the 4 strong route, all right? So he will push over to cut that 4 strong run. Alright, so what you have to understand is when you're running concepts like this, how do they handle 4 out to that side? Alright, how are they going to handle 4 guys out to that side? So what may be a better option for you is you may be better running 2 on corner with 1 on snag, all right? And now you're making the Mikes run a lot further, okay? You're making the Mike run a lot further to get to that drop, okay? Or you may even be better when it's that defense. You may even be better going 3 corner, 2 spot, 1 snag. Okay. Because now when you get 2 on the spot, you've got to hope that the spot either eats up the Mike linebacker, all right, or you've got to hope that the Mike linebacker, if he continues to push the whole thing, can't get to the snag of number 1 because of where that snag is. All right. So you're hoping that the Mike linebacker, if they're going to push everything that way when they get 4 strong, okay, if they're going to push it that way when they get 4 strong, you're hoping that the Mike can't get to the snag of 1. So you're trying to make the snag come from a wider position so that the Mike can't get there if they're going to push leverage on the flare, push the backside Will to cut over here, and then they're going to push the Mike and kind of flood the coverage strong that way. Now, what you always got to do in these spacing concepts is on the backside, you got to build in some gifts, some access throw gifts that you can take, because what happens now is if this is the structure of the coverage and 4 is going to be a hard cut player this way, you're going to get 1-on-1 on the backside. All right, you're going to get 1-on-1 on the backside. So if they can push their Will over to match some of your spacing routes, I still think you have some options that you can run within your spacing routes to create more space. Run the snags by 1 instead of 2 and 3. Run it by 1 and 2 or 1 and 3 with the snag spot, push the back, and make the Mike run further. But the other thing you've got to be able to do is build in something on the backside so that if teams are really good with flooding the coverage out, or if teams, for whatever reason, on backfield motion, go to a buzz scenario to where they get an extra defender now to that side, and now they've really got it flooded out because they buzzed down and rolled, you can go backside, because when your quarterback sees the rotation, he knows that he's going to get man-to-man on the backside. All right? Now, without releasing the back, a pretty good one against this type of coverage without getting quads out there, the back out there, a pretty good one here is vert by one and then double out by two and three. Okay, because now what you're doing is if you can get the corner to get out of here and push vertical for four or five to the out cut so that the corner doesn't drive the out if it's that type of two read coverage, now what you're doing is you're putting this guy in a bind and you're making the mic run to the throw. Instead of bringing the snag or the spot back to the mic, you're now bringing it away from him. So now what you've got is you've got a situation where if the Sam pushes to the first or tries to get underneath that outcut, you have this outcut right here. If the Sam just kind of hangs in this window in between two and three, you should get this outcut here. Okay? And then always build into this some type of bench route, all right, at about 14, somewhere around there. Some type of bench route so that if they are teams that can trigger down on two on the outcut, this guy's got to get his eyes to one, and that's a pretty bad angle because he better get his eyes and his feet to where one's going. All right, some teams will break flat and then redirect. Some teams will break and win over the top. But the hardest ball they have to defend, if you have the quarterback that can make that throw, is when they trigger corner down and you throw the whole shot out there. So that's another way to build into your spacing route. If you know you're getting that kind of coverage, build the whole shot in there. So now that if the corner's a guy that wants to come down, you have the whole shot there. If the corner's a guy that hangs, now you've got spacing on that Sam linebacker. Okay? So, if they're a team that plays coverage kind of like we try to play 3-by-1, to where they are going to lock one down, and now they're going to play like two read off of two and three. Okay? They're going to play two read off of two and three, and then they're going to try and leave a backside player down here. All right? Well, now what you want to do is you want to push the back here. Okay? You want to push the back there. All right? What you want to do is you want to bring three on the spot, and now it's up to you how you want to do it versus this coverage. I like one completely out because I think it's man-to-man by the corner. I like three on the spot. I like two on the snag. The reason I like that is because in this coverage, the Mike linebacker is really worried about that back getting out and out-leveraging him. So a lot of times when that back pushes, you'll get this Mike to push. The will cut four strong. Four strong is now going to become that spot route. So go ahead and let the will cut four strong. Now that the will has cut four strong, all right, now you've got the bind on the mic to play the snag and the flare route. Now remember, this strong safety, dollar, money, star, got to remember he is three to the flat first, shuffling out because he's also a vertical two player. So it's very hard in this type of concept. This guy is really the corner in Palm's defense. That's really what he is. So it's very hard for him to shuffle out to read three to the flat first. If three doesn't go to the flat, he's going to become kind of an all of two player. Well, while he's doing that, if two is working inside of him, it's very difficult for him to come and drive down. All right? That's extremely difficult to do, so the burden now gets put on the mic in that situation to either push to the flare or to sit on the snag. Okay? Now, a lot of you guys are going to say, well, if that's the case, why don't they just trigger the strong safety down here? All right? Trigger the strong safety down here and sit the mic underneath that route. Well, because if they don't know that route's coming and all of a sudden you pull four verticals and now you pull this and this, they can't play four verticals. All right? Because the strong safety in that coverage is the vertical of two player. So normally on backfield motion, they're not going to take him off vertical of two to drive the backfield motion. All right? What they may do, again, is you may get a drop down and a spin. so that they can, if they feel like they want to defend spacing stuff, they can buzz down and spin so that now they can get a guy in the flat, a guy that can hold, all right, a guy that can help hold the snag of the spots coming in that hook curl, and then they could still, all right, probably if they're going to buzz, you'll have your mic more in here and your will here, because if they're going to buzz, your will is going to help more that way, because now you've got the mic, the free safety, and now the strong safety. So you got these three guys flooded out front side, and normally you'll get the corner bail. All right, so the answers aren't always that easy to just say, well, coach, when the back motion's out, put the strong safety on the back and the mic on the snag. Well, yeah, if you know that play's coming, obviously that's something you can do. If you don't know that play's coming and all of a sudden we go vertical and this guy pulls down, all right, on that route, we're going to get a chance to win somewhere. They're going to have to use this backside safety somewhere over here to help. Well, remember, when you're playing this concept of defense, the reason you're playing it is because you want to get 2-for-1 and help back on this side. The reason you play that type of coverage is so that your weak safety can stay over here and not pull 3-vertical. Because when the weak safety has to pull 3-vertical, you're going to get all man-to-man concepts back here. All right. So you have to understand the structure that you're trying to attack, and you have to understand how you want to attack each structure. So spacing routes are a very good way to attack those types of coverages. And all you're really trying to do is put an extra guy in a situation where, with your splits and with your route distribution, to where those guys can't really cover or match all those guys. So another thing you can do, just like the other route we drew up before, another thing you can do is, before we drew up double out cuts to this coverage, what you can draw up is double in cuts. Okay, so now weak safety should be hanging his hat somewhere back on this side. Okay, now what happens is I like to do it with the back set away, so maybe I can hold the will a little bit and not let the will kind of cut 4-strong. All right, because now when I do this, I don't want the will to cut 4-strong. Because what I'm doing is I'm trying to put the bind on the mic. If the mic bypasses this first route, we should be able to throw the outcut. As long as that we're not getting a hard cut by the will, we should be able to throw the outcut, the in-cut, I'm sorry, underneath the mic. If the mic holds the short wall of 3, now we should be able to get, all right, the in route to the number 2 defender, or number 2 receiver, I'm sorry. Because remember, this strong safety is going to be a shuffle out player. He's getting a vertical at him. He's going to shuffle out and get ready to play it man. By the time he realizes it's an in cut and he drives, we should have plenty of space in there to complete a pass. All right, so you have to understand the coverages that you're going against. And you have to understand, your guys or your receivers have to understand the space that you're trying to create. Because in a spacing concept, you're not running man-type routes to try and get open on a man. What you're trying to do is occupy space so that all of these players cannot defend all of that space because they're shorthanded somewhere. All right, and in each coverage, unless they drop 8, if it's a 4-man rush and there's 7 guys dropping, other than man-free or zero-type stuff, when it's a zone coverage team, especially a pattern match team, but even if it's a spot drop team, they're going to be short on all those zones. They can't cover all the underneath zones. And that's where a lot of the great passing concepts, when guys like Sid Gilman came out and started throwing the ball and doing some things, what they started realizing was there's way too many underneath horizontal spaces for these players to cover. They can't cover all those spaces. So if we find ways to put guys in situations to where we use that space, all right, we use that space accordingly, they can't cover all that space on the field. So that's where some of the, you know, whether it be air raid or West Coast stuff, a lot of guys started using these spacing concepts where they were horizontally stretching a defense and putting routes in situations that the defense could not handle. All right, so another good one, if you want to go four strong, another good one to this is kind of a mini curl concept to where you go spot by three, you go 8 yard curl by two with a back push flip. All right, so another spacing concept. This is kind of a mini curl concept, but versus this type of coverage, now what happens is if they want to cut four strong, then give them a guy to cut right now. So let the will push and cut four strong. That's fine. Okay, give them that guy. Because now what's going to happen is the mic has to decide, do I want to hold the mini curl window or do I want to drive or at least expand to the back? So now if the mic expands to the back, you should be able to throw the mini curl in here with a good quarterback and a good receiver all day. If the mic sits in the mini curl window and you get the ball out again, we like to read this first. If the quarterback punch 1-2-3 ball out, okay, punch 1-2-3 ball out, and you have leverage on the mic and the strong safety's holding the mini curl because it's a vertical at him, now you're going to get this guy out here in space with the mic chasing him inside out. That's a matchup we'll take all day long. All right, so that's another version of a spacing concept that you can run, spot, mini curl as opposed to snag, spot, mini curl, all right, push four strong and get four out. And then what you'll force them to do is you'll force them versus four strong to either come with some type of rotated coverage. If he's going to come down, he's going to go to the middle. He goes to the middle. Now I know I got to go back here. So remember now, when we're talking about schemes on a whiteboard, a good defensive coordinator can come up right now and draw how he would stop that concept. So you got to have an answer built in. If they want to rotate a safety down and push a safety to the middle, because now when they flood the coverage that way, they bring a safety down, they now have, technically they have a hook player, they have a curl player, and they have a flat player. So to that side, that's what they want. What they don't want is they don't want a hook curl player and a curl flat player. That's what we're trying to take advantage of. We're trying to take advantage of a hook slash curl, curl slash flat defender. And we're trying to do that by putting guys in spaces so that they can't cover both of those areas. If they flood the coverage and bring a safety down, now they've got a hook, curl, and flat defender. So now they can handle the route that's in the hook, the route that's in the curl, and a guy can drive the flat. But you got to remember, in order for them to do that, they've got to gain help somewhere now, because if these guys are coming down and you get... Because they don't, you gotta remember, they don't know the routes they're getting. They have an idea off of film what you like to run, but if you're a four vertical team and you're pushing this guy here and you're pushing this guy there, if they are gonna rotate down in some type of buzz scenario, they have to have answers for that. And each team is different with how they answer it, but they have to have answers. They can't just rotate, spin down, and say, hey, spacing's done, you're dead. Well, yeah, you're right, spacing's done on that side. But there's other things that can attack that coverage, and then they're also leaving you back here one-on-one, which a lot of defenses don't like to do. Okay, so spacing routes are good intermediate throws. They're easy for the quarterback to do. They're easy throws that the quarterback can make. They can be done multiple ways, various ways. A lot of good teams will motion and shift guys and then run spacing, so they change who 1, 2, and 3 are. They'll trade you or shift you, all right, into situations where the 1, 2, and 3 are constantly changing, which makes it harder on the defense. So you can shift and motion to these. You can run them out of bunches. You can run them out of stacks. But the bottom line when you're running spacing is you're trying to get guys based on the coverage that they're playing. And again, I say this on a lot of the videos that I do. The more you know about the other side of the ball, the better chance you have of being successful. If you're an offensive guy that doesn't understand coverages, then you're going to have a hard time being successful because you're going to have a hard time understanding how they're going to react to certain things. So if you're an offensive guy that has coached defensive football or coached coverages on the back end, you got a better chance of being a good passing game coordinator because you'll know not only the coverages you're seeing, but you'll know the responses that you're going to get. So another easy way to do it . All right, stick by two, flare by one, take off, flare by the back, I'm sorry, take off by one. Okay? When you look at this play, this is really, all right, this play, what we call our three-man snag or our scat concept, and this play, which in air raid terminology is known as Y stick, it's really the same play. You're just changing who's doing what. Because now, here's your vertical top, here's your inside route, here's your outside route. All right? If I draw the three-man snag in blue, now look at the concept in blue. Corner's going back to where the vertical of one is going to go in the stick concept. The snag is coming in here and it's becoming the stick, and the flat route is still the flat route. So in theory, Y stick and three-man scat are very similar in nature. You're attacking the same parts of the field. So now you can go back to now, so your quarterback can have some consistency by running this stick concept. You're still kind of giving the same thing. You're telling them, hey, look, we're going to go top-down vertical, okay? Then we're going to go to hitch. Then we're going to go to, all right, tailback push flip. Now, what we will do most of the time is this will be a peak concept to where we're only going to throw that if we get a chance. They come out in palms coverage or soft coverage. We don't even look at that anymore, all right? I'll tell my quarterback to make it a true spacing theory. And we'll go one to two because that throw is longer and harder by the time that guy goes in motion. So if we know we're getting this coverage and the vertical's not there, the first thing we'll check is, can he play the back, yes or no? If he can't play the back, we'll put it on the back right now. If he can play the back, then we'll come back and we'll throw, all right, the stick in there. And then again, understanding that when you run this type of concept, you are going to get push and push, have an answer to the backside. All right, a good simple answer to the backside is smoke. Here, here. All right, we're half slide, back out to the front side. That's hot, that's hot. Obviously, if any of those backers come, we've got to throw the stick route or we've got to throw the flare route. If nobody comes and we get push, now what we're going to do is we're going to take this guard after he sets, and we're going to get him out and up. We're going to take this center, and we're going to get him flat and up. We're going to take this backside guard, and we're going to get him flat and clean up trash. Because now think about the numbers on the backside. And I've talked about this on other videos I've done, reading away from the mic, pushing the tailback, reading away from the mic. It's the same thing in spacing. If they push to cover spacing, have answers away from the side that they're going to push. So spacing concepts are real cheap and easy, in my opinion. Easy ways out of different formations. You can do it out of 2x2. You can do it out of 3x1. You can quad release it and get four guys out there and make it a spacing concept. You can lead the back in and make it a spacing concept. You could add play action if you wanted to, make it a spacing concept. You can even go two-man spacing on the backside of a structure that you know. A lot of times in two back, we'll get eight man fronts. Okay, so a lot of times in two back for us, we'll see eight man fronts, and this is changing nowadays with RPOs and other things, but for a while, we would see split field coverage, true eight man fronts with a safety down and a corner off. For a while, that's what we were seeing. So when we were seeing this type of concept, we would run a two-man game where we would go snag, flare, here. And we would put all the pressure on that defender. And if that defender widened, we threw the snag. If that defender stayed, we threw the flare to the back. More often than not, he pushed with the back and we threw this route right here. The next thing that everything progresses to is you run that concept with some type of quarterback run in here. So now if that guy leaves with the flare, you come back and run because you've just taken their extra fitter out of the box, and now you can come back with some type of quarterback run. Could be any quarterback run you want. You'd want it hopefully to hit on this side over here. All right, so maybe the better drawing would be ISO back here, and now it'd be quarterback punch one, read, and get back up there in an RPO setting. But the theory is you're running it off of a two-man spacing concept to the weak side off of a drop-down defender. All right, so you can run spacing to a single. You can make it a two-man game. You can run it at a two-by-two with a back and make it a three-man game. You can push a tailback over in trips, quads release, and make it a four-man game. The reason I like it is it handles multiple coverages. The reason I like it is also because my quarterback, I think, can make those throws if your quarterback is taught the proper way. And I think you can build other things off of those concepts. I'm always looking for concepts that I can build another thing to. So anytime I go spacing, I can build something off of my push so that if we get a push with our back out, or if we get a cut strong from a player, you can always build some things to kind of counteract the defense. So I highly suggest you run some version of spacing concepts. If you're a really good passing team, you probably have 15 more spacing concepts than that, and you probably throw the ball 35 or 40 times a game. We keep our spacing concepts kind of constricted and as limited as possible because A, we're a tempo team and we don't want to carry that much. B, we're not a drop back football team, so I'm not going to throw the ball 30 times a game. Why have 15 versions of spacing if I'm only going to throw spacing concepts 6 times a game? So normally what I like to do is carry the spacing concepts that I know attack the coverages that I'm going to play that week. So once I figure out what their 1 or 2 3-by-1 checks are, I'm going to carry 3-by-1 spacing concepts that can attack those 3-by-1 coverages. If I know how they play 2 detached or 2-by-2 sets, I want to run a spacing concept that can attack how they play 2-by-2 sets. Now, also keep in mind, on the marker, everything's great. Whoever has the marker last is going to win. In the game, it comes down to execution. You've got to have answers. They could spin guys. They could roll guys. That's what makes football such a great game is we can't just sit here and draw and say, okay, well, in that coverage, I do this. I win every time. You still got to block somebody. You still have to throw the ball. You still have to catch the ball. Kids still have to execute. So how many spacing concepts you want is up to you. How exotic you get with your spacing concepts is up to you. If you want to shift, trade, motion to get into spacing concepts coming from stacks or bunches, completely up to you. But the thing you got to keep in mind is carry spacing concepts because they're simple for your quarterback to make easy intermediate throws. They're not throws that you're asking him to hit and hold. And when he hits and holds, he's making reads and balls have to come out and be 22 to 26 yards down the field. Or even if they're only 14 yards down the field, if they're 14 yards down the field to a receiver on the numbers, that throw is going to be over 25 yards. So the spacing throws with guys usually coming back into them and a flat route going out, those are throws that every quarterback should make because the throws themselves should be under 18 or 16 yards or whatever they may be. All right, if your heels are at 5 and you drop 3 and get to 9 and a guy runs a 6-yard spot inside back to you, that should be a 15 to a 16-yard throw at the most. All right, now I know guys are going to say, well, it's a 6-yard throw because he's 6 yards off the ball. But, yeah, the quarterback is 9 yards or 8 yards deep. So the ball's got to travel 8 yards first, then 6 yards to that player, so it's a 14-yard throw. The snag will probably be a 19 to 20-yard throw or an 18-yard throw. The flare, depending on how wide he gets, will be a 10 to 14-yard throw, somewhere in there. Those numbers are not exact. I've never measured it. But just in theory, keep in mind of where the quarterback drops to, where the routes are, what he's trying to throw. Intermediate routes will always be easier for the quarterback to throw than those balls that have to get down the field with some kind of velocity on. All right. Also, these are good plays early in the game to get your quarterback in rhythm. Give him a simple flare or a snag, something he can throw and get confidence built in so that he can get in rhythm and he can now feel. Early on, I like to script easy throws like this so he can make an easy read, an easy throw, and take the butterflies away. I don't like to script early on things that have to go you know, down the field a bunch or things that might involve a couple reads from him, and then he's got to place the ball in the right section. I like to get him comfortable first, so I like to throw spacing concepts, screens, nows, bubbles, things that hopefully he can come out, get a couple completions, settle down, and then we can go from there. All right, I hope you guys enjoyed the spacing concepts. Hopefully they can help you out. 2 weeks I'll be in Atlanta, February 24th and 25th. Got about 8 sessions I'm speaking in Atlanta. 3 weeks from that I'll be in Tampa speaking, and I've got, I think, 6 sessions there. So anybody that's in the Atlanta area in the next 2 weeks at the Atlanta 150 Glacier, come out and check out some of the stuff we're doing. If anybody's in Tampa in 3 weeks, March 3rd, and you're going to be at the Glacier in Tampa, come out and check out some of the stuff we're doing. Catch me, and if you want to talk about anything or anything, if you see me at a clinic and you want to talk about any of these concepts, as long as I'm not listening to somebody speak or as long as I'm not speaking, I'd love to sit down, talk, and draw it up all the time. Hopefully we can help you, and maybe I might even get some ideas from you that help me. All right, as always, you won't play well until you play fast. See you next time.